Now, if national governments embrace electric vehicles, how should their adoption be accelerated? How are municipal, state, national, and supranational governments playing their roles? What policy instruments are available, and which ones are actually being employed in the stimulation of electric mobility? In view of the adverse health effects of NOx and particulate matter in the air we breathe, these and many other compounds are subject to air quality standards. In the European Union, air quality standards have been established by the European Commission to be enshrined in national law by the member states. Air quality standards are usually expressed in hourly average, daily average, and yearly average limits. So enforcing air quality standards requires an extensive monitoring effort on a national scale as well as local scales. For that reason, many national, regional, and municipal governments have been keen to curb traffic and to stimulate cleaner transportation in many different ways. And we will discuss some of the most prominent policy options to reach these goals by using the example of the state of California. Because California was the first in 1990 to install zero-emission vehicle regulation, and it is still expanding that effort in order to meet its air quality and greenhouse gas emission reduction goals. By 2050, 87% of cars on the road of California must be zero-emission vehicles. The California Air Resources Board, the CARB, targets the car manufacturing industry as well as the demand side of the market. New motorized vehicles and engines must be certified by the CARB for emission compliance before they are legal for sale, use, or registration in California. Moreover, the California Air Resources Board has installed a zero-emission vehicle mandate. This entails that car manufacturers are obliged to sell a certain percentage of zero-emission vehicles of all the cars they sell in the entire fleet. And this percentage, this mandate, is increased on an annual basis. Then on the other side, on the demand side of the market, consumers are stimulated in different ways to buy plug-in hybrid and zero-emission vehicles. They are entitled to rebates, for example, on the buying price of qualifying clean cars, and they are even given permission to use dedicated high-occupancy vehicle lanes, even if they are driving their cars without any passengers. The state of California is furthermore co-funding the rollout of hydrogen infrastructure, hydrogen for fuel cell cars and hydrogen for hydrogen internal combustion engine cars. And it is co-funding the rollout of recharging infrastructure for battery electric vehicles. By the end of 2017, 50 hydrogen fueling stations were expected to be operational, and approximately 1,000 public charging stations are already available for plug-in electric vehicles. However, electric vehicles and other zero-emission vehicles are not the only solution to improve the livability of the urban environment. Municipal governments have many options to combine in smart mobility strategies. They are keen to reduce the number of cars on the road in order to reduce congestion by offering attractive zero or at least low-emission public transportation options. Many big cities rely on mass rapid transit systems, mostly train, metro, and light rail systems, but also bus rapid transit systems, such as in the Brazilian city of Curitiba. Many cities are replacing their conventional bus fleets or converting them to low or zero-emission fleets based on natural gas or hydrogen, if not electric. Many municipal governments are also actively stimulating their residents to walk and cycle by allocating more public space to pedestrians in car-free areas and providing green corridors with dedicated walkways and cycling infrastructure. To clear the space, they can stimulate electric car sharing schemes, which reduce the need for parking spaces on the longer term. Many cities worldwide have already established environmental zones where the most polluting cars are forbidden access. And on top of national stimulation measures, many cities are also developing their own initiatives to encourage zero-emission vehicles, such as electric vehicles, through subsidies, through provision of free parking permits, and through aggressive expansion of the number of public charging stations. The city of Amsterdam expects to expand the current number of 2,200 public charging stations in the city to 4,000 in 2018. That's almost double. Many national, state, and municipal governments act as launching customers and role models by turning their own vehicle fleets into zero or low emission vehicle fleets. But now, when it comes to reducing carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gas emissions, we also see policy measures being developed at a different level in a concerted effort between nation states. In Europe, approximately 50% of greenhouse emission sources are covered by the so-called European Emission Trading System, the ETS, a market in which emissions from a variety of sources are traded under a cap which is gradually lowered. Many states and countries outside Europe are experimenting with or have already established their own emission trading systems, such as China. Emissions by vehicles on the road, however, are not covered by the European emission trading system. They are subject to emission reduction targets that are defined by the European Commission, at least in Europe, per member state and per sector, which is not covered by the ETS. Together with the electrification of vehicles, governments are also promoting renewable energy sources. The fluctuating supply of these sources, which are often employed at a local, decentralized scale, can go hand in hand with electric vehicles. Electric vehicle batteries provide the storage capacity needed to ensure the stability of the power grid. Their potential can be exploited by demand response schemes. However, the complexity of power grid operations will strongly increase if electric mobility becomes an essential component of the future renewable energy system. To engage electric car owners in demand response schemes, a retail market has to be designed in which car owners become providers of flexibility services to the power system. And such schemes will not only require a lot of ICT support, but will also require governments to adapt the current regulatory framework of the electricity market. Many governments are experimenting now with so-called smart charging strategies or vehicle-to-grid technologies. So proactive thinking on regulatory change and new incentive schemes will be needed to pave the way for advanced electric vehicle business models. With the so-called Clean Mobility Package, launched in November 2017, the European Commission commits to very ambitious targets of EU fleet-wide carbon dioxide emissions of new passenger cars and vans to help accelerate the transition to low and zero emission vehicles. Both for new cars and vans, the average carbon dioxide emissions will have to be 30% lower in 2030 compared to 2021. That's a massive reduction in 9 years' time. Even if the Clean Mobility Package is largely driven by the Paris Climate Agreement, by climate policy goals, it will certainly accelerate the adoption of zero-emission vehicles. Moreover, the package addresses the need for better efficiency in all modes for transport of goods, requiring new technologies as well as better organization of transport processes with new business models. The Clean Mobility Package fits into the wider European policy to make European industry stronger and more competitive, striving for world leadership in innovation, digitalization, and decarbonization. With the latest EU package of energy policy measures, clean energy for all Europeans, the Commission wants the EU to lead the clean energy transition, not only adapt to it. Today's proposals, they say, have three main goals: putting energy efficiency first, achieving global leadership in renewable energies, and providing a fair deal for consumers. While the package does not specifically refer to electric vehicles, it does contain measures to ensure the rollout of infrastructure for electric mobility at all buildings, and that includes non-residential buildings. Time to wrap up. So far, we have seen a variety of policy instruments being employed: market design, law and regulation, monitoring, and of course, law enforcement, financial instruments, technology development and innovation, and behavioral incentives. We have seen supranational, national, regional, and local governments struggling to reconcile climate policy, energy policy, industry policy, and air quality goals while satisfying increasing mobility needs. In general, governments are reluctant to select one specific technology to support so as not to distort competition in the market and put a potentially better technology at a disadvantage. At some point, however, the government has to intervene in setting standards to accommodate a new technology, such as standards for public charging infrastructure in the case of electric vehicles. Besides the competition between different zero-emission vehicle technologies, governments have many other options to improve livability and air quality in cities by improving public transport and providing better infrastructure for pedestrians and cyclists. Those are ways to offer a new choice architecture aimed at making other options than using the car the preferred choice. A lot to think about. Thank you for watching.